بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. Beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, if you had to ask every single Muslim who is seated here today, what is your goal in life? What is your mission? What are you here for? What is the main thing you want to achieve? If you had to ask everybody who is seated here today, as well as every single Muslim who came from the very beginning, all the way up to the end, they would say, our main goal is Jannah. We are here to attain Jannah bi-idhnillah. Towards the end of Surah Qaf, Allah Jalla wa'ala says, there will be a group of people. It will be said to them, udkhuluha bi-salam. Enter into Jannah with salam, with peace, with tranquility, with safety. ذَلِكَ يَوْمُ الْخُلُودِ. This is the day of eternity. No more worry after that. Not only this, لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ فِيهَا. They will have in Jannah whatever they wish. لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ فِيهَا وَلَدَيْنَا مَزِيدٌ. And Allah Jalla wa'ala says, and we have something extra for them. If you had to tie what we just mentioned, where every single Muslim's goal is Jannah, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that there will be a group of people who will be promised Jannah, they will be entered into Jannah, the question that should be on every single one of us lips is, the question on every single one of us lips should be, what did these people do in order to attain Jannah? In Surah Qaf, Allah Jalla wa'ala mentions that they had five qualities. What are these qualities? Inshallah, today we want to discuss them. Allah Jalla wa'ala says, وَأُزْلِفَتِ الْجَنَّةُ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ غَيْرَ بَعِيدٍ. Jannah has been made close for those who have which qualities? The first is لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, those who have taqwa. We generally translate taqwa as what? As God consciousness, or some translate taqwa as doing good deeds and staying away from evil, such that you erect a barrier between the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and yourself. If you have to ponder over taqwa, ask yourself, what does taqwa really mean? If you had to reflect over this God consciousness, you would realize that it is very closely related to ihsan. What is ihsan? Ihsan, as defined by the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه. To worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as though you can see him. فَإِن لَمْ تَكُنْ تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكُ. If you're unable to attain that extremely high level, there's a level slightly lower. Know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is watching you. What does this entail? This entails excellence in every single thing that you do. So notice how the first quality of the people of Jannah, Allah Jalla wa'ala is saying that they have taqwa, and we mentioned how taqwa is closely related to excellence. A lot of people, whenever they hear about ibadah and taqwa, they only think that it's to do with your salah. It's not only to do with salah. Yes, when you're performing your salah, you try to perform it with concentration in the best possible manner. But it also entails looking at your salah. Have you performed your wudu in the best of manner? Have you read your sunan and completed your salah? Notice how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is mentioning that this is one of the qualities of the people of Jannah, is that they are always God conscious, not only when it comes to salah, when it comes to zakah. Have you given what is compulsory upon you, or are you slightly short? Have you given it to those who are most deserving? That is part of being God conscious. Not only when it comes to your ibadat with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, also when it comes to your interaction with the people. And notice how this excellence, when you ponder over the word ahsan and muhsin in the Quran, you find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions it in countless places. When speaking to somebody, when speaking to another Muslim, Allah Jalla wa'ala orders us. Does he say that speak that which is good only? No. He says, وَقُلْ لِعِبَادِي يَقُولُ الَّتِي هِيَ أَحْسَنُ. tell my worshippers to say that which is best. Notice how it's a level above that which is just good. When you greet somebody, وَإِذَا حُيِّيتُم بِتَحِيَّةٍ فَحَيُّوا بِأَحْسَنَ مِنْهَا أَوْ رُدُّوهَا. When somebody greets you and you want to return that greeting, you return that greeting with that which is best. Why? Because you are conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is pleased when you behave in this way. In fact, when there is somebody who you have a problem with, some enmity, Allah says, idfa billati hiya ahsan. You want to respond, you want to retaliate, retaliate in the best possible manner. And you will find this person, فَإِذَا الَّذِي بَيْنَكَ وَبَيْنَهُ عَدَاوَةٌ كَأَنَّهُ وَلِيٌّ حَمِيمٌ. You'll find that this person eventually, bi-idhnillah, becomes a close friend. So my beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, the very first quality that these people, who it will be said to them, enter into Jannah, bi-salam, with peace and tranquility, they have taqwa. They are God conscious. The second quality, Allah Jalla wa Ala says, هَذَا مَا تُوْعَدُونَ لِكُلِّ أَوَّابٍ حَفِيظٍ. What is awwab? A lot of the scholars mention awwab is somebody who constantly returns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after they've committed or made a mistake. Look at our father Adam alayhi salam. This story, we all know the story, but what I want you to ponder over is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Look at how Allah Jalla wa Ala honored Adam alayhi salam by creating him. He was the first human being to be created. Allah Jalla wa Ala honored him by teaching him all the names. وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. Allah Jalla wa Ala honored him again by making the angels prostrate to him. Allah Jalla wa Ala honored him by allowing him to live in Jannah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also honored him by telling him that there is this one tree, stay away from it, don't come close to it. And what happens? It was decreed that our father Adam alayhi salam made a mistake. Even after being honored and after being warned, it was decreed that he still made a mistake. What does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do? Allah says, فَتَلَقَّى آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ. Allah Jalla wa Ala taught him how to repent. Notice how he's made the mistake. He knows that he's erred, but the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is such that he teaches him how to repent, and not only that, فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ. He accepts this tawbah. You know, at times when you have a problem with somebody, you have an argument, you have an altercation, they may say that we've forgiven you, but you can feel that things are not the same. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he teaches you how to repent and he wants to give you. Look at Sulaiman alayhi salam. Sulaiman alayhi salam, after realizing that he had erred and made a mistake, what does he do? Immediately he says, قَالَ رَبِّ اغْفِرْ لِي. O Allah, O my Lord, forgive me. He doesn't stop there. He says, وَهَبْ لِي, and give me. Give me what? مُلْكًا لَا يَنْبَغِي لِأَحَدٍ مِّن بَعْدِي. Give me kingdom, give me wealth that nobody will get after me. إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْوَهَّابِ. You are the one who gives without wanting anything. Why? Sulaiman alayhi salam knew who is Allah Jalla wa Ala. That's why you find sometimes a person, when they become practicing, they may say, okay, now I'm performing my salah, etc. And I just want one thing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, maybe something simple. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-wahhab. He wants to give you, even if you've committed a sin, even if you've made a mistake, ask of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and he'll give you. Somebody may say that here we are speaking about the anbiya. We are speaking about the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. What about somebody who hasn't performed any salah in their life? They don't know any good deed that they've done. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also has a message for them and for me and for every single one of us. He says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. Tell those who have exceeded the limit, they've oppressed themselves, they've fallen and they are drowning in sin. What's the message to them? لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not only should you have hope, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who forgives all sins. إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who loves to forgive. So my beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, notice how the second quality of the people who are promised Jannah is they are awwab. Those who, Allah didn't say they don't sin or they don't make a mistake. He says as soon as they make a mistake, they turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala immediately. So be from those who immediately turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sometimes a bad word comes out of your mouth. Sometimes you look at that which you are not supposed to look at. Or you may have a dealing which may have been, I wouldn't say prohibited, but there may be something wrong. It's not completely clear. Immediately make istighfar and turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah jalla wa ala then mentions the third quality of these people. He says hafiz. The scholars mention when it comes to the word hafiz, they say somebody who's been given a responsibility, they've been entrusted with something and they fulfilled this responsibility, and this entails everything. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put you in charge of something. You have a family, for example, or you have a wife, somebody has a husband, etc. In the marital home, there are rights, there are responsibilities, and this person fulfilled those responsibilities. And when you look through the Quran and you look through the Hadith, you find that those who were close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not only did they benefit in the Akhirah, not only are they promised a reward in the Akhirah, but they also benefit in this world. That's why in Sahih al-Bukhari, we all know the story of the three who were locked in the cave. They were trapped, there was a boulder. And we all know that the first person, when he made dua, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save them from the calamity and affliction they were in. And he said, because he was obedient to his parents, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the boulder or the rock move a little bit. They still couldn't come out. The second person, he left sin when he was able to commit this sin for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the boulder moved a little bit. They were still unable to come out. I want to touch on the third person. The third person, he says, oh Allah, I had somebody who was working for me and he left his wage behind. He was owed something. In some of the riwayat of the hadith, it's mentioned that it was a few grains, either of rice or corn or whatever it may be. This person says, oh Allah, I took this little wealth and I grew it. In our terms, I invested it. And this wealth grew so much so that I was able to acquire goats and cows and sheep. And years later, this person came to me and he said, Ya Abdullah, O servant of Allah, give me that which is my right and my due. Imagine, he left a few grains. And later on, he's coming and asking for that which is for him. So this man says, I told him, O Allah, whatever you see, all the animals you see, all the wealth you see is yours. And he says, this person came and he took everything. He didn't leave anything behind. What are we getting at? We're getting at somebody who was entrusted and given a responsibility and they looked after it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved them from the affliction they were in this world. And imagine the reward that awaits these people in the Akhirah. So that's the third quality, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam. Whatever you've been entrusted with, you have a responsibility. You have been put in a position at your workplace. You may be a manager. You may be at the lowest level. You still have responsibility. Be that person who carries out these responsibilities in the best possible manner. Allah Jalla wa Ala then says, "Man khashiya ar-Rahman bil ghayb." Whoever fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whilst alone, in the unseen, whilst in solitude. And this, my dear brothers and sisters in Islam, if a person, especially in the world we live in today, if they are able to fulfill this quality, if they are able to attain this quality, you will find that they will have an abundance of goodness. Man khashiya ar-Rahman bil ghayb. That's why Allah Jalla wa Ala He informs us that he will test us. We all know the verse wherein Allah says, وَلَنَبْلُوَنَّكُمْ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الْخَوْفِ وَالْجُوعِ. We will most definitely test you with fear and hunger, and you will lose people, people will pass away, etc. We all know that verse. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also says that he will test you when you are alone. That's why addressing the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, he says, whilst they were in ihram, and as we know, when you're in ihram, you're not allowed to hunt. Allah Jalla wa Ala says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu. O you who believe, لَيَبْلُوَنَّكُمُ بِشَيْءٍ مِّنَ الصَّيْدِ تَنَالُهُ أَيْدِيكُمْ وَرِمَاحُكُمْ. Allah is most definitely going to test you. With what? With that which he told you not to do. There will be some sayd, some animals which you're able to hunt very easily. Your hands will be able to get hold of them. Your spears and whatever you hunt with, it will be very easy. But you're not allowed to do it. Why does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala test them? He says, لِيَعْلَمَ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَخَافُهُ بِالْغَيْبِ. So that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows who truly fears him whilst they are alone, whilst nobody is watching. That's why Yusuf alayhi salam, we all know the story where he stayed in prison for a very long time. Then he's asked to come out of the prison. He doesn't come out immediately. He wants to clear his name. What does he say? ذَلِكَ لِيَعْلَمَ أَنِّي لَمْ أَخُنْهُ بِالْغَيْبِ. So that the people know, my master knows that I did not cheat, I did not deceive whilst I was alone. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in various verses in the Quran, he makes mention of this. Whilst you are alone, be somebody who worships Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and know that there will be a reward for you, bi-ithnillah, in this world, on the day of Qiyamah, as well as in Jannah. That's why Yusuf alayhi salam, after he comes out of the prison, where does he go? Straight to the top. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives him tamkeen. When the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is speaking about the seven who will be shaded on the day of Qiyamah, he mentions somebody. He says, وَرَجُلٌ ذَكَرَ اللَّهَ خَالِيًا فَفَاضَتْ عَيْنَاهُ. A person who he remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When he's in the masjid and all the people can see him? No. He says, ذَكَرَ اللَّهَ خَالِيًا. He remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he's alone. He remembers his sin. He remembers the fact that he has disobeyed the Creator. He understands and acknowledges the gifts of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon him. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, ذَكَرَ اللَّهَ خَالِيًا. He remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whilst he is alone. فَفَاضَتْ عَيْنَاهُ. And his eyes tear. When was the last time? Ask yourself. When was the last time you were alone and you remembered Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you were that person who teared for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So look at how Allah jalla wa ala, when mentioning the people of Jannah, he says, man khashiya ar-rahman bil ghayb, the one who fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whilst he's alone, whilst nobody can see. You know, sometimes a lot of people say, I read the Quran, but I don't see or I don't feel myself benefiting from the Quran. There's a reason for that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Yasin, he mentions one of these reasons. He says, addressing the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, there's a group of people, وَسَوَاءٌ عَلَيْهِمْ أَأَنذَرْتَهُمْ أَمْ لَمْ تُنذِرْهُمْ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ. Whether you remind them or you don't remind them, they're not going to benefit from this reminder. Why? Because their hearts are closed. Then he says, Allah makes mention of who benefits, who truly benefits from the message of the Quran. He says, إِنَّمَا تُنذِرُ مَنِ اتَّبَعَ الذِّكْرَ وَخَشِيَ الرَّحْمَنَ بِالْغَيْبِ. Those who truly benefit from the Quran are those who, yes, when the Quran is recited, when the Quran is discussed, when the tafsir is given, they come to listen. But not only that, they fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when they are alone. If you want to benefit from the Quran, or if you feel that you are somebody who hasn't truly benefited from the Quran, ask yourself, am I somebody when I'm alone? Am I thinking of sin Or am I thinking of that which pleases Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Man khashiya ar-Rahman bil ghayb. And the fifth quality that Allah Jalla wa Ala mentions in this verse, he says, وَجَاءَ بِقَلْبٍ مُنِيبٍ. And a person who comes with a clean and clear heart. Obviously, clean and clear from associating partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This person is attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His heart is clean. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says in a hadith, أَلَا وَإِنَّ فِي الْجَسَدِ مُضْغَةٍ. Indeed, in the body, there is a piece of flesh, a morsel of flesh. إِذَا صَلَحَتْ صَلَحَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ. If it is sound, if it is healthy, the whole body is healthy. The whole body follows suit. وَإِذَا فَسَدَتْ فَسَدَ الْجَسَدُ كُلُّهُ. And if it is corrupt, if it is ill, the whole body is ill. أَلَا وَهِيَ الْقَلْبِ. Indeed, it is the heart. So notice how it's extremely important to purify the heart. That's why Ibrahim alayhi salam, when making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, وَلَا تُخْزِنِي يَوْمَ يُبْعَثُونَ. Don't disgrace me on the day that everybody will be resurrected. يَوْمَ لَا يَنْفَعُ مَالٌ وَلَا بَنُونَ. On that day, no children and no wealth will help. They will be of no benefit. What will benefit? إِلَّا مَنْ أَتَى اللَّهَ بِقَلْبٍ سَلِيمٍ. The only thing that will benefit on that day is the one who comes with a clear and sound heart, sound from all ailments and diseases of the heart. And the diseases of the heart are many. It's a science on its own. And the way a person purifies and cleanses the heart is obviously by turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, repenting for the mistakes they made, having a close relationship with the Quran. That's why if you notice, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, he says something very interesting in Surah Al-Hujurat. He says, وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ حَبَّبَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْإِيمَانَ وَزَيَّنَهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. It's not that somebody just came and they tried one off to come to the masjid or to perform salah or to give charity one off, and then that didn't affect them, no. He says, as for the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, Allah made them love Iman and He beautified it where? Apparently, no, in the heart. وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ حَبَّبَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْإِيمَانِ وَزَيَّنَهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ وَكَرَّهَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْكُفْرَ وَالْفُسُوقَ وَالْعِصْيَانِ. And the same heart, He made it dislike evil, all that which is bad, all that which is filthy. And that is how the Sahaba radiallahu anhum benefited. That's why addressing those who were trapped at Badr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنْ يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ خَيْرًا يُؤْتِكُمْ خَيْرًا. If there is goodness in your heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you goodness. Some of the Mufassireen mention that Al-Abbas radiallahu anhu, who was the uncle of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, him and a few others who were Muslims hiding their iman. When the conquest of Makkah happened, some of their wealth was taken away because people didn't know they were Muslims. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling them, don't worry what passed. إِنْ يَعْلَمِ اللَّهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ خَيْرًا يُؤْتِكُمْ خَيْرًا. If there is goodness in your hearts, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you goodness. The wealth you lost, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you more. Whatever people, etc., you've lost, whatever worldly material you've lost, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant you goodness. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, we mentioned these five qualities, that it will be said to those who possess them, those who are attached to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, those who worshipped Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone, those who had a good relationship with all the people around them and the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it will be said to them, أُدْخُلُوهَا بِسَلَامٍ. Enter into Jannah with salam, with peace, with tranquility, with safety. ذَلِكَ يَوْمُ الْخُلُودِ. And this, once they enter, it will be forever. There will be no hardship after that. لَهُمْ مَا يَشَاءُونَ فِيهَا. They will be given whatever they wish, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant them something extra. When you look at these verses, how many are there? Five? It may take a person 10 seconds to read. Few seconds to read, But it will take a lifetime and more to try and implement these verses in our lives. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calls on every single one of us. The message is for all of us. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Do they not ponder and reflect over the Qur'an? Yes, the Qur'an is for reciting. A person will be rewarded. And as important is to understand what the King of Kings, your Maker, is telling you. أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ. Do they not ponder? Do they not reflect over the Qur'an? In another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the reason why He revealed the Qur'an. He says, كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ. This blessed book that we have revealed, why have we revealed it? Is it just to decorate the houses? Is it just to read and see which person has completed and done so many khatams? No. لِيَدَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ. So they may ponder and reflect over its verses. You will find that when you come closer to the Qur'an and when you come closer to the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who made you, you will find barakah in your life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open your doors. Whatever you thought to be difficult and impossible, you will know and you will have full yaqeen and conviction that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who promised, Udu'uni astajib lakum, call out to me and I will respond to you, He is the one who will give you. He is the one who will grant you. He is the one who is close to you. And you will find that peace and sakina and tranquility from within. That's why Allah Jalla wa Ala says, Ala bi dhikri Allahi tatma'innu al-qulub. Indeed, it's only by the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, do the hearts find tranquility, do the hearts find ease, do the hearts find sakina and safety. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, for those coming in now, we mentioned that they are five qualities. Just to quickly recap, we said that the first is taqwa. A person must be a muttaqi, somebody who is always conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second is a person must be awwab. Anytime you make a mistake, don't feel useless. Don't feel that there is no hope for me. Look at Ya'qub alayhi salam. After Yusuf alayhi salam went missing, and Binyamin went missing, and the other son who had promised to bring back Binyamin, he did not want to come back. What does Ya'qub alayhi salam tell his children? It's been so many years. It's been years and he's been crying and he's gone blind. What does he tell them? La tayasu min rawhillah. Don't lose hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Always be that person who has hope. And when you make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, know that it's an act of worship to make dua, and it's also an act of worship to be waiting for the response of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's also an act of worship. You will also be rewarded for your patience. And that's why in the hadith, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informs us that a person's dua will be responded to as long as he is not hasty. And the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they ask, what is this haste, O Messenger of Allah? And they say, this person says, I made dua to Allah, da'awtu, I called out to him, and I called out to him, and I called out to him, falam yustajab li, and he did not respond to my dua. This person's dua is not accepted. Somebody may say, a whole lifetime I've made dua and I haven't seen the response. What we don't realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is al-hakim. He is the most wise and the most knowledgeable. Sometimes you are asking for something and Allah knows that it's not in your best interest to have that thing. Hence, He saves you from some calamity, or He gives you something better, or He has saved a reward for you in the akhirah. The day you need your deeds the most, then you will see that dua. So we mentioned the second quality is a person should be awwab, always turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he should be somebody who is hafidh, who whatever he's been entrusted with, whatever he's been given in terms of responsibility, he should be somebody who looks after these responsibilities. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam informs us that we will be asked about every single thing. Every single thing that Allah gave you, you will be asked about. And when it comes to wealth, there will be two questions. Where did you get it from and where did you spend it? We all know the hadith where the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, a person won't move on the day of Qiyamah until he's asked a few things. And he says he'll be asked about his good health. What did he do with this health? And the fact that a person keeps himself healthy, it's a responsibility. It's an amana. Your body is an amana. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave it to you. Look at how he tells the anbiya alayhim as-salatu was-salam. We all know many verses in the Quran. Allah tells them how they should worship him alone, how they should convey the message. And he also tells them about food. He says, Ya ayyuha rusul, kulu min at-tayyibat. O messengers, eat from that which is pure. Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, kulu min at-tayyibat. O you who believe, eat from that which is pure and halal and tayyib. So all this is responsibility. You will be asked about it. Your body, what did you do with it? Allah gave you time. Allah gave you life. What did you do with your life? A lot of times we get engrossed in the material world and we only think that our lives are from a certain time to a certain time is work, and then there's play, and then there's sleep, and we carry on like that, not realizing that it most definitely will come to an end. It has to come to an end. It has to come to an end. Allah says, wherever you are, death will reach you. قُلْ إِنَّ الْمَوْتَ الَّذِي تَفِرُّونَ مِنْهُ فَإِنَّهُ مُلَاقِيكُمْ. That death that you're running away from, it will most definitely meet you. Even if you are in a fortress, in a castle, you feel that you are physically protected, that death will come to you. أَيْنَمَا تَكُونُوا يُدْرِكُّمُ الْمَوْتِ وَلَوْ كُنْتُمْ فِي بُرُوجٍ مُشَيَّدًا. Wherever you are, that death will most definitely come to you. My beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, we will most definitely meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We've got to ask ourselves from now, what have we prepared for that meeting? What have we done? Ask yourself, ponder over this. You know the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, the scholars who came before. They would be those who, when they were alone, they would remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They would take account of every single thing that they did. And so much so, you find some of the scholars who, when they were praised for some good deed that they may have done, they used to make dua to Allah. And they would say, Oh Allah, make me better in your sight than what they think of me. Make me better in your sight so they think I'm a good person. Let them think what they want, but make me even better. So we've got to take account of ourselves and we've got to prepare for the meeting of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A person, it's not too late for them to get hold of the Quran, to memorize the Quran, to learn the Quran. We all know the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he received revelation at the age of 40. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, his close friend, was only a few years younger than him. They say 2 or 3. So that means what? He must have been 37, 38, somewhere there. He also memorized the Quran. Okay, if a person can't memorize the Quran, ask yourself, the few short surah in the Quran, Surah Al-Fatiha, do I know them? Am I reciting them correctly? Do I know what they mean? In every single salah, I either hear the imam reciting, or I'm reciting, or I know it's supposed to be recited, at least Surah Fatiha. Do I know what it means? Do I know what the King of Kings is telling me? When you embark on this journey, a journey towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, bi-idhnillah, you find that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open your doors and He will make whatever difficulty you have easy for you, bi-idhnillah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from those who possess the qualities of Jannah. We ask Him to make us from those who are gathered in Jannah. In the same way we are sitting here today, may He gather us all in the highest parts of Jannah without any reckoning, without any punishment. Ameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in.